So I've been hearing a lot of talk about the identity of Mashiach.
As the title suggests, tonight's going to be the big reveal. The big reveal. So who are the candidates? Anybody here want to try their luck? Oh.
Not saying you should ignore them, but those other people that you're hanging your hats on, talk to them.
Mashiach is going to be coming. Ani, meaning that he doesn't care about all this Kashmir of this world, materialistic. And he's going to go on the Chamor, on the Chumiyot, on the materialism. He's going to overcome his desires to do stupid things and sins. That's Mashiach.
When Mashiach will come, it is described as tunnels, as they're coming through tunnels and the ground is opening up and they're coming out. This is all a description which is highlighting the fact that in the Zohar, at the end of Parshas Balak, the Zohar describes there the events that will unfold before Mashiach comes. At the end of Parshas Balak, the Zohar quotes the verse, Arenu v'layata sherenu v'laykariv, the prophecy of Bilam, that he sees the coming of Mashiach in the distant future. And the Zohar elaborates on different events that will unfold, which will lead up to the coming of Mashiach. And most importantly, in our preparation for the coming of Mashiach, so we'll take a look. There's any connection between the concept of tunnels and the coming of Mashiach.
Earlier today, I asked you a question. I said, how would you feel if I called you a monster?
If you called me a monster, my first reaction to that is a negative one. I generally associate monsters with demonic forces that we all have inside of us. But I want to know where you're going with this.
I think we're all monsters. I think some of us hide the fact that we're monsters more than others. Other people are willing to show what they're capable of.
Will the real Mashiach please stand up?
Hashem already focused. He said, okay, I'm telling you my vision. I'm telling you my plan. My plan is Mashiach, who's going to be at the end of time. But he was already present at the very beginning.
It is really the Messianic light. In other words, the information of that Messianic light is so great that it will ultimately change the entire world. Now, beauty is a very important concept. What beauty is when many, many different pieces fit together in a harmonious blend. So if you look at it individually, then each one seems to be a separate piece. But if you see them all together, there's some type of what comes out of that is a tremendous integration that expresses a beauty far beyond the pieces. Are we looking at something which is fragmented? Or are we rather looking at something which is all together, it's all integrated, you see?
He's here. I don't believe he's in Jerusalem. I do believe, however, he's in New York. He's in the United States. And that may sound odd, but the reason for that is that the Mashiach, Messiah, is born and raised in a country that he will ultimately change. I don't know if I want to use the word overthrow, because I don't know if that's the proper word, but clearly modify, radically alter and change. We find that to be very true.
May I merit to sit in the shadow of his donkey's dung. So what, only Rashaim is scared of the Mashiach? Let's see.
Into a structure where you can see each piece. Not only understand each piece, but you can understand the relationship between each piece. You see, that's a very important idea. Because essentially, the difference between the Sheikh Ben Yosef's wisdom, you see, which is really the Messianic light, and the wisdom that we have today, is that the wisdom we have today is all piecemeal. It's all fragmented. It's called pirut. Everything is separate, you see. But the Mashiach ben Yosef, what he does is he weaves everything together into a beautiful tapestry or fabric, where when you look at one piece, you're not. You're looking at the totality, the scope of the Chochmah. The Torah, in many ways, is fragmented, you see. We don't see the underlying theme. what connects the entire Torah together? We don't see that. That is concealed from us. So what the Mashiach ben Yosef does is that he unifies everything. He integrates everything. But he integrates not only the physical world, but he integrates the spiritual world, and then he integrates the physical with the spiritual, and the spiritual with the physical. You see, where everything is seen as a tremendous jigsaw puzzle looking at the big picture. And apparently that chokhmah is the tremendous chokhmah or wisdom of reality. And what does everybody seek when you think about it? They want to know what is real. What is reality all about? You see, everybody wonders growing up, what is reality really? What's and value is, in this reality, what is important? That's the concept of value. But basic, first, is the concept of reality. What is it? So the reality of the wisdom of the Mashiach ben Yosef, which is the messianic light, is the real reality. You see, it goes from one end to the other end, where you see everything connected. And once you have that, then you could decide on value. Well, within that understanding of reality, right, what is important and what is not important? That's the concept of value. But you really can only have value when you have reality. And that's called the Kani Re'im. It's really what it is. That's the horns of a Re'im, which are magnificent horns, the symmetry and so on, the way they bend and fold and so on. And these are the weapons that the Mashiach ben Yosef uses. And that's how he convinces everybody the truth of God, the truth of his will. But somehow he is able to weave the reality of this world with the reality of the Torah and with the reality of all the spiritual worlds. And the metaphor for that is called the Kani Reim, the horn of the Reim.
People say, I can't wait for Mashiach to come. Why? If you say, I can't wait for Mashiach to come, by default, that means you know nothing about Torah. Why? You'll see. Know where you stand. Isn't he allowed to disagree with them? No. What? You have to be at his level.
Yes, wait a minute. So does he get ruchnistic abilities when he becomes the Mashiach? No. He has them now while he's walking around as a Clark Kent. You see? And he knows that Mashiach, he said, well, he's over there. Oh, so he said, when is he coming? What are you asking me for? Go ask the Mashiach. He's right over there. It's like, you know, he's your local neighbor.
I am a true prophet, Hasdik Alameen. I'm the truthful one.
Mashiach ben Yosef can conquer the Yetzer Hara, but they can't. Eshboruah HaKadosh. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Fill my cup, Berkasam Azon. Three cups are filled, and now for the fourth cup, for Yesod, for the foundation, for Yesod.
Times I have died every day waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid. I have loved you for 1,000 years. I have loved you for 1,000 more. Instead, you shall spill your blood for me. You shall spill your blood for me, and I shall be your Zonia, your witch wife. Zonia means wife in Polish. You know, till the end of your life, I shall be your Zonia then. That is my wish. My wish is for you to say it 3 times in my ear. Once more, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will appear. Yeah, once more, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will appear. One who will arise to rule over the Gentiles. In him, the Gentiles will put their hope. Indeed, because Mashiach ben Yosef is here, and Mashiach ben Yosef is the foreigner. You know, they already exposed him. They already exposed him to the entire world to see. I'm using it not for sin, but to slay them. I'm using it to slay them because they tried to slay me. They already did it. They already exposed me. They were sinning, not me. Asdik al-Amin, from Hamad al-Mahdi.
turn the Yetzer Hara into a Pegasus or a unicorn, the conquering of the Yetzer Hara, which Mashiach Ben Yosef can do, bringing about a new messianic age, where it's no longer going to be about shame anymore. There's been enough shame and enough war and pillaging. For they were scared of Mashiach Ben Yosef. They were scared that he was going to slay thee. And indeed he will, for they were using it for evil, but now he shall use it for good. For he is Mashiach Ben Yosef, and he is basically going to flip the switch. Flip the switch.
You know, anyone that has a little bit of understanding of what a Jewish king is, it's a very, very deep and powerful concept. But a king, when people would appoint a king, right? What was there's two levels here. One thing was just a form of government. You had a person that had exceptional qualities. Instead of having a democracy where you have a whole Senate and a Congress and they fight and eat each other's throat the whole day, you had absolute authority, absolute control. That was that. But then, that explanation is not really good enough, because the fear, the bittul, the nullification that people felt wasn't only because they themselves appointed him as their king. The fear that they felt from the king, the Rebbe Rashab explains, the roimimus of a melech, the bittul, the nullification that people had in front of a king, was an atzmiistik of bittul. Like, as if this king is essentially exalted. Not just he's exalted because the nation handed him over the power. When a king becomes a king, what happens is, so to say, a certain manifestation of the Eibishter's kingdom from above that is expressed in this person. So therefore, and it's true that you crowned them as king. So in a certain sense, you could say it was initiated by the people. But what was initiated? But when they crowned him as king, at that point, they brought upon him something which is, they endowed him with something which is much greater than them themselves. They endowed him with a manifestation of the Eibishter's kingdom, which is something which, you know, when a person stands in front of the king, being in the presence of someone that has that manifestation of kingdom, they become totally nullified. The Rebbe Rashab goes on to further to explain that a true king is someone that even before you crown them has that Reimimus Atzmus, has that essential exaltness, that he essentially is higher than everyone else. The justice is concealed. By crowning him, you bring it out in a revealed way.
You're going to invite the king and say, long live the king. And like I always point out, that when Mashiach comes and everyone says, long live the king, so the king is going to say, you know, it's easy for you to say that when I'm sitting on my throne. But what about when I was on the run? What about when I wasn't sitting on my throne? And everybody knows that the loyalty is really built when the king is, so to speak, on the run. When he's not sitting on his throne, when his throne is in ruins.
All the later things that Mashiach does are expressions of Mashiach, the way they affect the world, so to say. The essence of Mashiach is something much higher than that. It's the etzim of Mashiach, which is be'etzim higher, essentially it's higher than fixing up the world and all the beautiful things that he does. That has to be expressed in the world. The world can't remain dark. Mashiach could be in the world. It has to be expressed. The essence of Mashiach is expressed, all the things that he does, but it starts off with something which is totally beyond the world itself.
And he will be extremely high. So it says, He will be raised, number one. Number two, he will be carried. And the third level, he will be higher than anything, every entity, every piece of knowledge out there. And what Chazal say in them to that, he will be higher than the angels. What?
What really, some of the anti-Semitism is because they want to see the Jewish people that they read about in the Torah, you know? I think they want to see us, they want to see the great people that merit Hashem to do miracles for them. And when they see, unfortunately, right, you know, these horrible actions, these horrible traits, it's like, that's not the Jewish people I learned about, you know, that's not Hashem's people, right? And it creates, like you're saying, I think,
the people that are committing these nasty things in the world, they're not following, you know, the ways of the Torah. They're not following the ways that they came out of Egypt. God took us out of Egypt. He took us out in order to be slaves to Him, right? In order to give us the Torah so that we may keep it, right? It wasn't just to go be, do whatever you want in the world and just have fun. God didn't take us out, we'd still be slaves to this day. We didn't have the power to take ourselves out.
Right, they don't like some of this, like, lack
of... But we gotta listen to what they're saying.
Okay.
What are they saying?
Right.
They're not saying, oh, you're ugly, or you're the people of the book, and we just don't like you. You know what I mean? They're not saying that.
No, they're saying
you're doing things that are anti-godly. They may not be saying anti-godly per se with those exact words.
Right.
But, you know, all the things that we mentioned, pulling people away from God, Jews who quote unquote rule the Hollywood industry, or, you know, that have influential power in banking and all that stuff.
So I think there's two separate things. I totally agree with you. Like, I think sometimes their tochacha, their rebuke of us, of what we're not doing right, of how we're not following the Torah properly, that's coming from Hashem through them, and Hashem's using them as like a way to motivate us.
You won't be able to play games with Mashiach. It would just be cutting. The truth would be so piercing.
You know, this is the Nephilim. It's possible that they were part of the Nephilim. I mean, we don't know for sure, but it's definitely,
if you're going to cause people to stray away from God, it's definitely, it seems like these are the unholy people that in the name of them being quote unquote Jewish.
And it's right, they started building the golden calf, and that caused, you know, this horrible avera. And really, you know, the Chazal, like, what it tells us is that our job is to not listen to the Erev, not be influenced by the Erev Rav, not follow after the Erev Rav, try to resist the Erev Rav. You know, don't listen to their bad teachings. Don't listen to when they teach something that's contradictory to the Torah. And I think what's also very harmful about the Erev Rav is they're perceived by the world and us as part of the Jewish people, and they cause great anti-Semitism. They cause great hatred of the Jewish people.
The root of what people today, you know, call anti-Semitism is really the world hating on these quote-unquote Jews, were really have their source in the mixed multitude, the Erev Rav, and they just happen to be, you know, amongst the Jewish people and in leadership positions. And so it's like, and that's what people are disgusted by, who look down upon, you know, in the way that they look at it. And today we want to label that as anti-Semitism.
Yeah.
And really, it's not. It's
Das for Yiras Hashem is going to be someone with Yiras Hashem, helping people tune in to being in awe of God.
The power to advocate against the forces of the accuser, the bad interpretation, is going to always result in accusations. Bad accusations that are fueled by bad interpretations of reality, that are fueled on lies. Because the reality is there's only God. Knowledge of God would restore that only good. Yosef has got a good eye, is able to perceive the all good in this reality, because he's experienced it more than other people. He's experienced just how good God is when you are in a situation where your life is hanging by a thread every moment of the day for a long time. And you experience the continual deliverance of God in that situation, and the continual transforming of that horrendous situation around to the good that it ultimately became. You know God. You know God. Yosef knew God.
He says, Mashiach comes, he's going to save all of the people. They used to be criminals against Hashem, but did tshuva.
Mashiach is going to teach the whole world where the sky is. Going to teach people normalcy, and they're going to learn and listen and do. That's the whole Chiddush of Mashiach.
Says, well, what's going to happen to the rest? Says, oh, the rest is going to destroy them. What? Yeah, Mechale Shabbat is going to destroy them. What?
Isaiah 52:10. Hashem has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, all ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God. This is actually, he's bared, make the same Hebrew word for somebody that has become naked. So there's no clothing covering it anymore. So if you would imagine, this is the Lord of hosts, and his robe always covers his right arm, his arm of might, always covers it. But when it becomes unveiled, you see he's bared his holy arm before all the nations. So this arm remains closed all the time because God doesn't want to bear his glory, which is his might, before the nations, because once it becomes bared, it means a great many destruction, meaning God is going to display his power on the earth and kill a great many people. This robe is very long, millions of millions, meaning his mercy and compassion is very great, very great. So it's only when it's removed is that mercy and compassion has run dry. And now it's time to display his might among the nations, which is Yahuwah, his name, which is his glory.
That's the concept of the revelation of Mashiach in general, how the Rebbe said it. The Rebbe said, if you wish, you can say it however you want, but I say that Mashiach will be revealed first here in Brooklyn.
Be a military warrior, almost a general of sorts.
So what does it mean Mashiach is going to force us, Jews and non-Jews, to serve God properly? When God's will becomes so obvious that everyone can see it without studying, without being spiritual, without being holy, without being idealistic even, just 20/20 vision, then you really have no free choice. Then how can you do anything else? It can't mean force against our will. Because if we still don't want, then we're not ready for Mashiach. Of course he's going to force us. He's going to make it so obvious and so clear and so logical, logically compelling, that we would have no choice. That's Mashiach.
In order for something new to come, something old must go. And that old can sometimes mean let go of what you know until now.
The more your willingness and your ability to let go, the more changes are going to come.
Empty the cup and start from the beginning.
For new things to come, old things must go.
You must spill the old tea and pour in new one. Then things look different.
Every door to me, hide all the world from me, bar all the windows and shut out the light. Do what you want with me, hate me and laugh at me, darken my daytime and torture my night.
He starts looking upwards, and then he's going, and then he's starting to move in the direction of the divine, the spiritual, the sublime, and all of this. But it comes not because he's a spiritual type, it's because he's a physical type, but he wants to go upwards. And so Yosef and Yehuda begin as foundation and kingdom, Yesod and Malchut, opposite of what Rabbi Cook spoke about, but their trajectories lead them to a role reversal. As we saw all throughout history, these two figures of Judaism are constantly revolving, and their roles are reversed. So,
where is the mitzvah of yearning for Mashiach? It says the smag, the rishon. When God says, I took you out of Egypt, It means that there's a destination that I'm bringing you towards. There's a mission here. There's a purpose to life.
But Yosef is the neshama of Mashiach ben Yosef.
As objective man, he is the mysterious yet ever-present personage about whom legends are rife, and is he who changes form yet remains ever the same. And it is he again who holds spiritual sway over the whole world. He is, as said, the nameless one who has so many names and yet whose names and whose very nature are unknown. He is the initiator called the Great Sacrifice. For sitting at the threshold of light, he looks into it from within the circle of darkness, which he will not cross, nor will he quit his post till the last day of this life cycle. Why does the solitary watcher remain at his self-chosen post? Why does he sit by the fountain of primeval wisdom, of which he drinks no longer, as he has naught to learn which he does not know? I neither on this earth nor in its heaven? Because the lonely, sore-footed pilgrims on their way back to their home are never sure to the last moment of not losing their way in this limitless desert of illusion and matter called Earth life.
Suddenly, he saw Ganymede, Prince of Troy, who was helping to shepherd the royal flocks. Ganymede had an almost divine beauty. Perhaps there had never been a mortal as beautiful as he was. Zeus decided that someone with such beauty was not meant to live among men. The presence of that gem would further enrich the abode of the gods. The supreme god took the form of an eagle and descended to Earth to abduct the beautiful Ganymede. The eagle surreptitiously flew over the young man. After descending toward him, the great bird grabbed Ganymede by surprise. The beautiful young man was gently carried by the divine bird toward Mount Olympus. Ganymede stood before the gods of Olympus. They were impressed by the beauty of the mere mortal. Zeus presented him as a substitute for Hebe in the celestial banqueting duties. Ganymede had the prestigious responsibility of serving nectar and ambrosia to the gods. The young man was also given the gift of immortality, retaining his youthful beauty forever. Ganymede was highly regarded by the gods, who valued the excellent service provided by the young man. Only the goddess Hera was not particularly fond of the cupbearer. She was jealous of the long periods that Zeus spent with the handsome young man. But Zeus's wife was not the only disgruntled person. The king and queen of Troy were extremely saddened by their son's disappearance. To lessen the pain of Ganymede's parents, Zeus created the constellation Aquarius, represented by the figure of young Ganymede. As they looked up into the sky, the parents knew that their son was in an honored place beside the gods of Olympus.
as I said, Earth, from a metaphysical standpoint, is about to become a sacred world. Hmm. And so as a sacred world, that means that only certain people will be allowed to incarnate on this planet who have a spiritual agenda, who are people that want to go after things of the spirit. Now, what I see is the birth of a central messianic figure.
So you're not talking about the Christian second coming here. You're talking about something completely different.
Correct. I'm talking about an incarnation. I'm talking about something that could actually happen, where you actually have a theological world leader that people recognize, not the beam of light.
An antichrist.
Possible. But remember, there's two comings of Christ. That the first one is if the world is in complete and utter chaos, yes, you have the beam of light with the Son of Man on the great white horse with the saucers and whirlwinds at his heels and faithful and true written on his thigh. But you have another one. And the other one is that if all of these warlike things kind of peter out, you actually have somebody who incarnates again and comes along and kind of takes over something. And you just remember, too, every religion has something or someone coming from the sky and putting them in charge, whether it's Islam, whether it's the Jews, whether it's the Christians, whether it's the Mormons. It's all about that.
It is under the direct, silent guidance of this Maha Guru that all the other less divine teachers and instructors of mankind became, from the first awakening of human consciousness, the guides of early humanity.
The destroyer, quote, is the creator and savior of spiritual man, as he is the good gardener of nature. He weeds out the plants, human and cosmic, to call to life the perceptions of the spiritual man. From the basin, like seven channels, issue the seven Sephiroth, for 10 equal seven.
So all opposites merge, because when things come in a defined level, on the level of Giluim, things don't, you don't see how they come directly from the Eibishter himself. Each thing is defined. Each thing is opposite of something else. But in the Eibishter himself, Yicholti Elohai, Yicholti Shalei Elohai is one thing. His ability to illuminate or to conceal is completely one. So when that is revealed, by Mashiach will be revealed that level. So that means that by Mashiach, the Maila and the Mata, what we have today is the higher worlds and lower worlds. The higher worlds come because Eibishter is revealed there. The lower worlds come because godliness is concealed. But when the level of Yichelos Ha'atzmus, the power of revelation and concealment, is revealed, at that level they're all one. The highest worlds and the lower worlds become one. So since by Mashiach himself, the Maila and the Mata by Mashiach will be completely one, so therefore it will affect the world at large as well.
The every perfect attribute there is. So the name that you have that describes a certain attribute of yourself, Mashiach has that. Mashiach has many attributes. But you're going to see in Mashiach yourself inside Mashiach.
Well, Aquarius is an air sign, an element associated with mind and thought. The double glyph also points to the capacity of Manas to function as an antaskarana bridge between heaven and earth, between the Akashic and the astral, the spiritual and the intellectual, the intuitive and the rational. The capacity to harmonize and synthesize the deepest flashes of insight and spiritual awakening with unconditional commitments to the service of all sentient beings and the reflection of both in the smallest circles of daily Dharma would seem to be one of the hallmarks of the Aquarian individual.
Because he would fain show the way to that region of freedom and light from which he is a voluntary exile himself. Because, in short, he has sacrificed himself for the sake of mankind.
Now, here's the deal. You have height, width, breadth. You have time, which is the fourth dimension, and time is what gives everything else meaning, okay? Because without time, everything is moving so quickly, it's like a car that spins around in a circle unless you put time into that equation. So what is the fifth dimension?
And the fifth dimension, the more that we're going to understand quite a lot of things. And I do want to say, just if you don't believe in God or any kind of religion, the phrase, God is everywhere. That's how he is everywhere, the fifth dimension.
The fifth dimension is being able to take that which you think and turn it into physical reality.
What it means to transition from 3D into 5D.
Are there any signs that Mashiach is coming?
The planet Pluto is always important because you have to look at where Pluto is in the chart of nations.
So let's fast forward to now when I think we're at the end of this cusp and about to go into the full, full age of Aquarius, marked by Pluto in Aquarius.
The world-changing, paradigm-shifting, mind-bending significance of Pluto in Aquarius. Pluto-Aquarius, as I've taken to calling it, has repeatedly timed momentous periods in history in which the structures of the world and our understanding of it were profoundly transformed. So the big question is, what does the current transit of Pluto through Aquarius, which will take us to the year 2044, promise for the world of today?
Hi, this is Greg from N5D.com at the Age of Aquarius. Each age lasts approximately 2,160 years. What do you think? Do you think the change will happen immediately? Comment below the video. That's it for now from N5D. Is this just another so-called coincidence?